Increase in knowledge. And while that can be a bad thing, we thank you that we're taking this technology and we are using it for your glory and for your honor so that we can begin to spread the gospel even more. There are people that are not a part of PFBC that are listening to this devotional this morning, and we thank you. God, we ask that you would fill them with your presence, that you would help them to know and understand that you love them unconditionally, no matter where they are, no matter what they've done. You love them right where they are. You just don't want them to stay there. And so, God, we thank you and praise you that you give us a mind to refine ourselves. You give us a mind to cultivate the relationship that we have with you. And we thank you that we're going to grow deeper and wider, and that we're going to go to higher heights. And we just bless you for it. In Jesus' name, thank God.
Days later, the high priest Ananias went down to Caesarea with some of the elders and a lawyer named Tertullus, and they brought their charges against Paul before the governor. When Paul was called in, Tertullus presented his case before Felix.
We have enjoyed a long period of peace under you, and your foresight has brought about reforms in this nation everywhere and in every way, most excellent Felix. We acknowledge this
with profound gratitude.
But in order not to weary you further, I would request that you be kind enough to hear us briefly. We have found this man to be a troublemaker, stirring up riots among the Jews all over the world. He's a ringleader of the Nazarene sect and even tried to desecrate the temple. So we seized him. By examining him yourself, you will be able to learn the truth about all these charges we are bringing against him.
The other Jews joined in the accusation, asserting that these things were true. When the governor motioned for him to speak, Paul replied,
I know that for a number of years you have been a judge over this nation, so I gladly make my defense. You can easily verify that no more than 12 days ago I went up to Jerusalem to worship. My accusers did not find me arguing with anyone at the temple, or stirring up a crowd in the synagogues, or anywhere else in the city. And they cannot prove to you the charges they are now making against me. However, I admit that I worship the God of our ancestors as a follower of the way, which they call a sect. I believe everything that is in accordance with the law, and that is written in the prophets, and I have the same hope in God as these people themselves have, that there will be a resurrection of both the righteous and the wicked. So I strive always to keep my conscience clear before God and all people. After an absence of several years, I came to Jerusalem to bring my people gifts for the poor and to present offerings. I was ceremonial clean when they found me in the temple courts doing this. There was no crowd with me, nor was I involved in any disturbance. But there are some Jews from the province of Asia who ought to be here before you and bring charges if they have anything against me. Or these who are here should state what crime they found in me when I stood before the Sanhedrin. Unless it was this one thing I shouted as I stood in their presence. It is concerning the resurrection of the dead that I am on trial before you today.
Then Felix, who was well acquainted with the way, adjourned the proceedings.
When Lysias the commander comes,
he said,
I will decide your case.
He ordered the centurion to keep Paul under guard, but to give him some freedom and permit his friends to take care of his needs. Several days later, Felix came with his wife Drusilla, who was Jewish. He sent for Paul and listened to him as he spoke about faith in Christ Jesus. As Paul talked about righteousness, self-control, and the judgment to come, Felix was afraid and said,
That's enough for now. You may leave. When I find it convenient, I will send for you.
At the same time, he was hoping that Paul would offer him a bribe, so he sent for him frequently and talked with him. When 2 years had passed, Felix was succeeded by Porcius Festus. But because Felix wanted to grant a favor to the Jews, he left Paul in prison.
You need discipline. You don't need a moment. Don't let the sun go down on your anger, and don't give the devil an opportunity, because when we are angry and we sin with what we say, and when we refuse to say what needs to be said, both of those scenarios give the devil a foothold inside of the relationship. Ephesians chapter 4, verses 29 and 30. Watch this one. No rotten talk should come out of your mouth, but only what is good for the building up of someone in need, in order to give grace to those who hear. Ooh, listen. Tap your neighbor right quick. Say, neighbor, no rotten talk should come out of your mouth. Okay, now let me deal with us good Christian people. All right, let me help us good Christian people. Because somebody's already asked, well, what is rotten talk? Let me help you understand rotten talk. Okay? Rotten has a couple of characteristics to it. Number one, it stinks. Number two, it's no good. It's lost its value. Number three, you don't want it for yourself. Ooh, how about that? How about you talk to me the way you would want me to talk to you? How about that? She said, that don't ever work. Listen. Let me help you understand something. This is not about the other person. This is 100% about you. You can't, we'll get to that. I promise you we'll get to it. This is not about that. This is 100% about you. This is about what you should do and how you should act. Listen to me carefully. He says, let no rotten talk come out of your mouth. No rotten talk. So what does that look like? Listen to me. To every relationship, there should be rules of engagement, especially in conflict. There should be rules of engagement to every relationship, especially in conflict. Now, let me help out some of the couples. Let me help out some couples. Friends, couples, all that. This will help everybody. Listen to me carefully. No rotten talk come out of your mouth. If you're a couple and you're together and you're in conflict, listen to me carefully. There should be rules of engagement. Here's the first rule of engagement. First rule of engagement is, because no rotten talk should come out of our mouths, there are just some words we are not going to use. Right? Listen, there are some words we just don't use. If you're married, you should never ever let the divorce word come out of your mouth. See, because we do that. We talk, and then as we talk, we throw out things to people, and we make threats. Well, shoot, I just gonna be on my own then. I don't need to be with you. Wait a minute. See, and I've learned this: the person doing all that threatening and talking is the first person to go crazy when the other person says, "Okay, I'm out." There's some words we just don't use. There's some phrases we won't say. Some things aren't allowed. You're not allowed to compare me to your last boyfriend. That's over the line. There's some things you just can't say. Stop telling me you're leaving me every 5 minutes. Because what that's going to do for me is it's going to start to slowly devalue this relationship in my mind. And when I devalue the relationship, I devalue you. When I devalue you, you get hurt. And I'm going to hurt you because you've hurt me because you've devalued the relationship, which devalues me. And all hurt comes from devaluation. There's some stuff you just can't say. No cussing. Some of y'all just cussed right there. No cussing. Well, what the? Some of y'all just cussed right in your spirit. You just... No cussing. Stop the cussing. Let me tell you why. Because cussing by when you're in conflict, when you're in conflict, cussing is naturally offensive. And in conflict, you never mean anything endearing by it. See, some of us cuss with endearment. See, y'all trying to be real holy and spiritual and act like you don't know what I'm talking about. There's some people right in here who will cuss you smooth out, and the whole thing is an act of endearment. That's my nigga right here. My nigga. This M over here. That's all endearment. It ain't right, but it's endearment. But you don't mean that when you say it in conflict. You don't mean it as a term of endearment. You mean it to hurt and to cut and to injure and to bruise. And so stop the cussing. And here's how you stop it in two ways. Number one, you stop cussing in conversation. And you stop cussing people out. Stop calling people out of their names. Because I have to control what comes out of my mouth. And she has to control what comes out of her. What goes on up here, listen, we can deal with all that. That's the lab. That's where we deal with stuff. But listen, but what goes on up here doesn't have to manifest itself out here. Because that's why I deal with it. And I'm talking and I'm praying and I'm, but Lord, and then God is also dealing with me up here too. So that by the time the lab work is done, my mouth and my body come out on a different place than where my mind was. That's why you can't say the first thing come into your mind. You need to just go with your first thought. No, you don't. Are you crazy? What trouble would you be in if you followed your first mind all the time? Listen, I be at so many court cases. Speak the truth, but speak it properly. Number three, this on my list of stuff that don't come out of our mouths. Stay away from always and never statements. And I'm gonna tell you why, because the moment you make an always and never statement, you're immediately lying. Because nobody always or never does anything. Stay away from sarcasm. Listen, Monique say, we need that. Sarcasm is fine when it's all playful and laugh, and jokey joke, ha ha. But in a serious conflict, sarcasm says, you're stupid. Which is devaluing somebody. Now, here's the problem, because what popped up in some of y'all heads, which is my wife who I'm really talking about, what popped up in my wife's head is this. If I can't use sarcasm, because sarcasm means that they're stupid, then what do you say to the stupid people? Listen, The goal is they're not stupid. Regard others as more important than yourselves. Listen, stay away from sarcasm. Sarcasm is the smart people way of telling you you're stupid without saying you stupid. Sarcasm is the intellectual, educated way of being able to converse with you in a dialectical fashion, where I can show you the ins and outs of conversation and take you for a trip down a road that ends in your stupidity, and it will be your own understanding and revelation. I'm going to make you call yourself stupid, is what I'm going to do. That's sarcasm. And the problem is, some of us are too smart to do anything else. Speak the truth properly.